Edmund Hillary. And those of you that aren't familiar with the New Zealand history, in 1953, Sir Edmund Hillary had one goal in mind, and that was to reach the peak of Mount Everest in Nepal. Now, I'm sure we can all agree that the Mount Everest is a fairly large mountain sitting at just over 29,000 feet above sea level. There's been many people before Sir Edmund Hillary attempting this mountain, but never quite made it. Unfortunately, they all perished. So Sir Edmund started to organise his resources. He assembled over 400 men, experts in the field of mountaineering, to help him get up the Mount Everest. He also took with him £10,000 worth of luggage, which is fairly quite a lot of resources, but this is what they needed to do in order to get to the summit safely. This journey is approximately 3 months in total to get there. So they took time and planned out every single step to make sure they were going to get there in one piece and actually live through that journey. On a balmy day in 1953, March 1953, I might add, Sir Edmund and his team started the trek up the mountain. They continued up the mountain, they got to camp one, they managed to get to camp two, and then unfortunately something happened. They were hit with a massive, massive storm, which no one had ever experienced before. It was the same type of storm that people had perished in the past trying to get up this mountain to get to the peak of Mount Everest. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop the slide there and I'm going to ask you a question. Those of you who run a web design business, does this resonate with you or your team at all whatsoever?
There is
no team. I know the feeling. I've been doing this business, I've been running a web design development business for 13 years now. We have started out as a web design business, evolved into software development, mainly using the Joomla CMS and Magento. 2 years ago, we moved into marketing, or now a HubSpot. And this particular story resonates with me because it sounds exactly like a website redesign or a website design if the client doesn't have a website. And the reason it sounds pretty much like a website redesign is because you need to try and find try and assemble a team to help you, especially if you're running your own business and you're on your own. Unfortunately, we're not all like PR20 here. We need to look at getting budget from the client, which is always a travesty. In most cases, no one actually talks about budget until the very last minute, whereas it should be the opposite way about. And typically for a small to medium-sized business, especially this is maybe dependent on your audience, it can be it can cost between 7K and 80K plus. Okay, on average it takes between 3 to 5 months depending on the type of website that's getting built. We have actually done ones that's taken 9 months plus, and obviously everything you need to try and organise during that is a shitload of stuff. So what you try and do is you try and organise everything with a project management system, irrespective of what you use. You try and work out when your meetings are, you try and work out what your deliverables are, just everything that goes along with trying to deliver a web design or redesign project. This incidentally looks like the side of a mountain as well. What's funny about this is really is that although you try and plan as much as you possibly can, you put every single detail into the website redesign, you speak with the client, they agree it, and lo and behold, 3 months down the line, you're still only halfway through it, it's over time, it's over budget, and it just becomes an absolute nightmare. To give you an example of that, just last year, actually, we had a multi-million pound IPTV business approach us. They already had a Joomla version 3 website, so life was pretty good at that point. And they were looking for a redesign and some development. In total, it was going to be taking 3 months, incidentally. It was roughly about 25 grand. It ran over, it was being managed by a project manager. They changed their marketing director halfway through the project. So as you can imagine, what they want is completely different things. So 6 months later, it was still running. It was over budget by about 10 grand at this point. And it got to the point where we had to just say, look, this is as far as we go now unless you give us more money, which incidentally they didn't. It's a nightmare. Yeah, so again, the emphasis here is about the time allocation. It always been, in most cases, delivered late. And I suppose what I'm really trying to tell you is the traditional web design process is just has systematic risks riddled right throughout it. So we'll have a look at the traditional web design process, or the risks involved are the upfront costs. Yep, so again, anything between 80 grand is a shitload of money, eh? Now, generally what we do is, we work with companies worldwide, so what we do is we take 50% of that upfront. So if we were doing a website, and we have done for a client in Brazil, which was 40k, we want 20 grand upfront before we even consider working on it. So it's quite expensive. The resources and time is always a bit of a travesty, especially when you're working on your own. It's hard, there's only for some reason to find Joomla developers anywhere, really. And yet we all seem to be here. And when you do find somebody, it never seems to work out. Because it goes over budget, I mean, that has other implications associated with it, such as, you know, when you're working with in a project-based type of business model, where you're working from project to project and no retainer, it has implications on the other projects that you're trying to work on, which then puts them out, and it just becomes a bit of a nightmare. Okay, so it's generally out of scope, over budget, and late. So these are the risks associated with the traditional web design process, and even though we do try very, very hard, I might add as well, to nail everything down at the beginning, it's just a continual problem. The thing is, this is probably more prevalent now that I'm working more in a marketing kind of sphere, is that when the process that I've experienced is generally the client comes to you with their brief because they've looked at their competitors and they see what their competitors have got and still do this. And they want that and want that and want that. But they've not actually tested this because everybody's business is different. Every web design business is different and their message is different, their audience is different. And there's no data backing up what the things, the features that they're looking for in that brief. So one of the biggest things about launching a website in the traditional manner is you just don't know if it's going to perform, you know? I mean, what we all want is we want a website that performs, we want a website that delivers leads, we want a website that delivers sales if it's e-commerce, and we want that working 24/7. And we just can't measure anything really with the traditional web design process. So this might be familiar to probably most of us. Generally what happens is the client comes along, gets a website, or the client comes along, wants a redesign of the website because it's just not working, or they'll say, I've got WordPress, I've got Joomla, WordPress, because WordPress is better at SEO, blah, blah, blah. We've all heard it, right? So they come to you, you ask them how long when the website was last done, they'll probably say about 18 months to 2 years ago. And yet, they're now looking to get a redesign. Of course, that's only after they've let it get even worse at performance. It's poor. It's nothing's been updated majorly for that length of time. And this day and age, technology moves on so fast. You need to keep things moving all the time. So they come along. They ask you for a redesign, and generally, because we've not went through any other type of process, we resort back to the traditional way of designing websites. And that's generally a 3-month journey back into the process, and the web designer comes up with a nice new design based on absolute hee-haw. There's been no data, nothing's been done to do any user research, anything about the buyer personas, nothing really about anything. It's just based on what they assume is going to look good, what's going to work, because their dog's uncle's cat has got a website which works fine with that slider, which nobody looks at. But the thing is, what we need to try and understand is your website is your number one marketing asset, you know? It's there 24/7, generating leads. Your salesperson is your number one salesperson as well, closing sales for you. So why would we not want to make sure, you know, that it's up to date all the time, that everything's working, it's functional. You're optimising things as you go, because we just don't do it. Need I say any more? You know, why do we do this? We leave it up to 2 years and then we go back for a redesign. It's just a continual process. And again, it's all based on assumptions from your developer or your designer and things, you know. You really need to look at another way of working. So we've looked at some of the risks here. Upfront costs, resources, time, out of scope, over budget, being delivered late, but there's a whole other raft of problems that we need to deal with. And that's one of the biggest ones to them is things are based on assumptions. Nothing's backed up by data, no research is ever done. And you know, I mean, in the time I've been working in this industry, we've had clients come to us that are spending 20, 30 grand, and they never have any user research either. And in actual fact, a lot of them didn't even have a brief. You know, they come to you and they say, I want this, this, and this, and you ask them why, and they didn't know. It's just because that's what they think is working at that particular time for other people. It's static for 2 years. Up to 2 years before it goes for a redesign, and it just doesn't perform. Okay, so Gabe from Square 2 Marketing says the traditional web design model is totally broken. Whether you're an agency or a business, it leaves you extremely vulnerable to project failure and often does not produce optimal results. So you're thinking to yourself, Derek, what are we going to do? Because this is crap, right? It's absolutely guff. And I'm tired of dealing with the same customers coming back for a redesign who didn't know really what they're doing. And yes, we're delivering what they want, but it's not what they need. Yeah? Don't worry. There's a better way to do things. And it requires a complete shift in your mindset. There's a smarter way to do web design, which isn't the traditional way, and that's called growth-driven design. Now, growth-driven design was the brainchild of Luke Summerfield, originally from Savvy Panda, who some of you might know, was taken over by Square 2 Marketing and works for HubSpot now. So this is a new methodology, a new concept, which is why probably nobody in the UK knows anything about it. It is quite hard to try and explain it to people, in some cases, more so clients or other agencies, because they're so woven into the old way of thinking, and we need to change that. So growth-driven design focuses on three main pillars. The first one is it minimises the risk of what we've already spoke about. Yep, so it minimises the long time frame, the cost, the over budget, and things being delivered late, and loads of other factors which are intermingled with that. It provides better results by learning and continuously improving the website based on actual user interaction, user data, and it informs other parts of the business to help them perform better, like sales and marketing. And sales and marketing also inform the growth-driven design. So I want to take you a little bit further into the growth-driven design process. There's three main phases within the growth-driven design process. Strategy, launchpad website, and continuous improvement. Now, in most cases, when you look at the traditional web design process, you'll generally have a strategy, or you'll try, or what you'll do is you'll look at the brief and say, yeah, I can deliver that. You provide a proposal which looks like the brief but regurgitated, and then you'll run with that. This is totally different. This is a different way of thinking. It's based on real user data. What we do is we create impact items from the user data, which we'll discuss later. And we iterate over the Launchpad website. So this is a continuous improvement monthly, month on month. So we essentially create like what's called a month sprint, and you decide last month what you're doing next month, and that just continually iterates over. Okay, so let's look at strategy. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to gain an empathetic view and understanding of how the user is using the website. Now, the way we do that is we make initially some fundamental assumptions about the user. It could be on a user level, it could be on a business level, but we make assumptions to begin with. And this is based on your user personas, which need to be developed beforehand or at this particular time, because if you didn't know who the persona is, you didn't know who you're marketing to, and if you didn't know who you're marketing to, your message isn't going to be right, and it's not going to be delivered at the right time, in which case it's just pointless. So once you're working through the personas, you need to ask questions of how is the website going to work for this particular persona. You might have more than one persona, in which case you then need to obviously answer questions for each and individual persona that you have. With that in mind, you create goals to make sure you don't stray off the process, and you just continually keep moving forward. At this point, once you've made the assumptions, you've got your persona sorted out, you've asked the questions, you're doing some user research, you're working through the goals, you want to create a journey mapping, which is user journeys. So what you want to do is, if that buyer persona lands on the homepage, what do we want them to do? We want them to take that particular action. So you would create these user journeys depending on what you wanted that goal to actually be. Again, from that, you can then carry out additional user research because obviously once you've created the user journeys, that kind of backs things up, and then that moves on to creating a global strategy. Now, in reality, what we've kind of spoke about so far is kind of what's included in the traditional web design process anyway. But where it gets a wee bit more exciting is we start creating brainstorming a wish list. So the goal is at this point to brainstorm a wish list of elements which solves the user's challenges and drives value for the website. So what that actually means is, at the strategy phase, is we create 75 to 200 different items, metrics if you like, which we would like, or features, which we would like to implement on the website. Might not be you, might obviously be something that you speak with your client. And what happens is, that could be additional sections, it could be additional pages. It's not something that's required right at this particular point, because what we're going to start doing is we're going to start filtering them through and prioritising them. Just about hit me in tongue there. Okay, so we move on to the Launchpad website. Okay, so what we're doing here is we're essentially building the core website, if you like, the things that we must have on the website for going live, which need to be obviously better than what you had previously. So this doesn't mean that you, like, during the traditional web design process, you know, the client comes to you with hundreds of different things and you think, goodness me, it's going to look like a Christmas tree. And what happens is we just filter everything out. We've already created a list at this point of 75 to 200 plus additional features that we want to add in, and we go with the core system. So at this point, everything's still going to be working better than the previous website, because you've done the user research, you know who your personas are, and the strategy's already set up for you. At this point as well, you would do your normal kind of stuff that you'd usually do within the traditional sense, such as user experience. You'd want to do Q&A, testing and wireframing and all that kind of stuff. So the goal for the Launchpad site is to launch as quickly as you possibly can. It's to try and help you come out of this little bubble that we all seem to live in, within the traditional sense where we are the web designers, so we know better, or you're the client and it's your business, so you know better, where incidentally that's generally not actually true. Who we're building the website for is the buyer personas, the people that's actually going to use it. And to be honest, when was the last time you were on your own website? So if we have a look at the traditional web design methodology, what generally happens, well, I've kind of touched on this already, is the designer that dictates what's actually going into the website. Yeah, the designer listens to what the requirement is, has a look at it and thinks to himself or herself, you know, that would really look fantastic as a slider which is going about 500 miles an hour, which need to can never read. Let's put that in there and this in there, and let's go and get Facebook because I've got Facebook and we need to have Facebook in there, and I need all my Twitter feeds in there too. And it's just a nightmare. Eh? So it works out that they end up with a website which again needs redesigned in a year and a half to 2 years' time. Now, I don't know if anybody's noticed that at the moment there seems to be a bit of a trend going on with the videos, background videos in the header area, within the hero part. Every man and their dog seems to have them, especially if you're an agency. This seems to be a trend, and there's been case studies proven that in actual fact there's been case studies proven that the hero area is the highest converting area, which is why you're supposed to have a call to action above the fold when your page loads. So So with growth-driven design is much different. It's all user, it's all based on user data. Everything gets tested, everything gets measured, and that's where the everything essentially comes from. So your users are telling you what they want to do, what they want to do, and how they use your site, and what they're looking for to get changed. Now you'll be able to see if anybody uses, does anybody use Google Analytics? No,
it was difficult for me for your accent to understand it. So could you rephrase it again?
Sure. Do you, well, I can speak it again.
Yeah.
Do you use Google Analytics?
Most of the time, no. I use PDIC. Okay.
Yeah. I think most of us can probably agree that when if you go in there, you don't know Google Analytics. It can be quite daunting because there's quite a lot of information in there. But it's absolutely detrimental in improving your website and getting the data out of that to make informed decisions. Okay, so with the growth-driven design methodology, with this background video, the data might actually show and tell you that in actual fact it's distracting. And it's distracting, and we know it's distracting because the bounce rate on that particular page has started to go up. People aren't scrolling past. The video's not being played for a certain length of time. And the data, again, might show that they just want something simple, which in most cases that is what they want. In terms of sliders, I mean, data shows if anybody follows Peep at Conversion XL, his research has also shown as well that sliders don't work, for instance. And if you want a slider, and you must have a slider because you've got 500 million messages that you want to try and convey to your customer who probably never read them, as you could put up a slider which an actual where they need to actually slide it themselves for it to see the next message. I'm sure everybody's experienced that where they're going to a website and they're actually reading some of the message and it slides away. So that's phase one of the growth-driven design phases covered. That takes between 30 to 45 days to get to a point where we're moving now to actually launch the website. Now, when we launch this website, what we're looking to do is we're looking to gather as much user data as possible, which will drive the continuous improvement section. So we'll just look at that now.
With that short time frame, when you're proposing this approach compared to a traditional approach that would cost, say, £20,000,
yep.
How are you cutting down on your first phase and what it costs in the second phase?
Yeah, so what you want to do at this point is we're actually creating the features and things. So these features would actually get built in at a later date. So you're going with a core system. Now, depending on how you feel about pricing will depend how obviously your pricing goes, but the growth-driven design methodology is all about retainer-based services rather than project-based, because project-based is just so unpredictable. And I've been in a position myself where you're bringing in 40 or 50 grand a month and you're thinking, this is fantastic, I'm going to retire shortly. And for 3 months after that, you're working that hard on these projects that you've brought in that you've not brought in any other money or any other projects. Eh? So the whole point to this is to try and get the retainer-based business model implemented. So what I do is I didn't charge anything up front. I hook them into a 12-month contract, so you're getting a minimum of 25 grand, sorry, 24 grand. And then from there, it's up to them if they want to continue. But I would like to think that within that continuous development, they've seen the differences that you're making. And again, that's you know, there's different plans. I mean, we started at 2 grand a month, so if they wanted split testing and things like that, then obviously, you know, you could be 8 grand a month. And there are clients out there that are willing to pay that amount of money.
So you target your first year to be within their total budget of traditional?
Usually, yeah.
You were saying we do go-to design at our company, same actual thing, do Luke. And his website, go-to-design.com, is a nice spreadsheet calculator where you can calculate your retainer. And for us, a year go-to design is 40% higher than traditional build because we
know yet, mate.
I'm sorry, I just wanted to go on.
Ah, go for it.
So, how's the client perceiving that? I mean, I see the value for a client.
Yep.
But I fear, at least in my country, that the main counterpoint for that from the client would be, I don't care because this type of growth-driven design is not budgetable in an easy way for me.
Well,
meaning, I prefer to have a full-blown quote from you, but that's what I'm going to spend.
Yeah.
And this is my budget. So yeah, I know that's better, but it's never going to be approved.
Well, the thing is, you need to educate them. Eh? I mean, the thing is, if you've got a client who's paying you 20 grand, right, for instance, and they say, that's my budget, I can guarantee you they'll pay you more than 20 grand because it'll be over budget, because you'll be working with the traditional means. And the thing is, how many times does that client come back to you for to get updates and, you, do you know what I mean? So, surely it's a better way to work if you're continually working with the client, not just from a user perspective, but from a business perspective as well, because their goals might change as well. And things are getting changed and modified and updated all the time, month for month.
Yeah, I see the value. I don't believe it's so easy to produce a client about that.
Mm-hmm. Well, the client's got a choice. Do you want to pay me 10 grand now?
Yeah.
Or do you want to pay me 2 grand now? So if they paid me 10 grand, right? That means they're getting their website delivered in 3 months. If they paid me 2 grand a month, I'm still working with them 5 months later. So their website's continually getting worked on all the time. Eh?
For me, I see the value, but I don't believe that.
Yeah, I think you would say, we'll stop at 2 months and whatever. Great, 4 grand, good.
the thing is, you got to make the client. You see, most of the time, when I sell a website, the client comes to me and does not know what he really wants.
Yeah.
It's like, do I want a suit? Do I want to wear a dress? Or should I go naked? I got no idea, but I will not tell that it's actually like that. So I go with them through a conception phase.
Yeah.
Where I set things up. And most probably you will do that too. But if you say, don't worry about it, just let us fix the very basic things. And then when you see also how things develop, you will get to know how it's being done better, because you know your business better than I do, but I know how to make it work in the internet. So we just do the very basic, we set that up, and then we go on a continual improvement. So most probably, it's also a bit like you do not buy the cat in the bag. You get something, you can see where it's heading, you're not just completely in or out, and so you can take really, I think, also the edge of the huge investment. And if they see, oh, I'm getting somewhere, they're most happily to give you more money. This is what I get.
I mean, growth-driven design. I'm sorry, Mario.
Is there any time frame that when you present to the client, for example, the first month, you have that result?
Yeah, usually, what I do anyway is I start the strategy phase pretty much right away. Because I work with HubSpot, what we do is we have an onboarding process, and that usually takes 3 months. So, in essence, nothing's actually happening for that. It sounds like nothing's happening for that 3 months, but you're actually getting everything set up. Eh? Because strategy isn't something that should be taken lightly. It's because you need to build the foundations of this. It's not just about going in and saying, yeah, that guy's got to pay me 12 grand and it's only going to take me 4 weeks to do it. If that's your mindset, then you probably need to get out of this job, because that's not what you should be doing. Eh? It should be about delivering the best quality website and continually developing that as a partnership, not just as a web design person or web designer or whatever they claim to call you. So what I do is I tie people in for the first 12 months. What I do is I sign them up into a 12-month contract, which generally covers most of the cost. If we were doing a 20 grand website, then I would maybe be 2 grand a month, and then we we do it that way. If it was a 50 grand website, which we've done before, then it would either be a longer contract or it would be 3 or 4 grand a month. By the way, if you're thinking that, you know, my clients will only go for this, you maybe need to start thinking about looking for different clients. Because in essence, the thing is, you need to understand who your own buyer persona is. And if you've got clients that come to you and they're wanting everything for literally nothing, then you need to start looking for other clients. Didn't service any people?
Good question. If you're starting on a new site, not a redesign,
yep.
Where do you get the data from?
There's no data.
Yeah. So how do you...
So that's why you need that's why you need a launchpad site.
Okay.
So
let's launch and let's put...
That's right. As soon as it's launched, within that period, then you start collecting user data. And as soon as you start collecting user data, that's when you start making informed decisions about where to go. What's the bounce rate of that page? What is that video being watched? In general, web design terms, each page should have one goal. You know, so you should have one call to action for that particular page. So you should be able to measure everything that happens in that page. I wrote a script which measures, we obviously use HubSpot now, but it measures everything, clicks. I mean, there's that many tools out there you can use as well, you know, for mapping your eyes and that kind of stuff. Or heat map, sorry. You know. So that's the type of stuff that you need to start using for to make more informed decisions.
Last question.
Yeah.
The 30, 45 days you mentioned for the Launchpad website,
yep.
Does that take into account also the strategy part?
Yes, for me it does.
So you're able to deliver something in like a month,
yep.
Even if it's just launched.
Mind, we're not looking for bells and whistles. We're not looking for a Christmas tree. We want to get something out there that's core.
Yeah.
I mean, I could get a Joomla website out of the day within 5 minutes.
My question. Meaning all the design issues that arises usually in the earlier part of the project.
Yep.
So where you actually sit with a client and discuss the strategy, find out do the wireframe personas and stuff,
yep.
Then go through design and find, I don't like this, and blah blah blah. That takes you less than 45 days?
Well, if you've got a design approved, the client shouldn't be coming back to you to say, I like this.
Okay,
yeah. Yep. He shouldn't, you know. And if he does, then that's the problem with traditional web design, eh?
Yeah, that's where I see this as dangerously close to the traditional one, is that phase.
Mm. Yeah.
Because that's still
traditional. We're never going to get away from doing those type of things, though. We still need to do wireframes. We still need to do designs and things, you know.
How do you shrink the time? Because really, in my cases, usually, it's not the number of features that slows the development.
Yep.
It's that first stupid
yep.
phase of content gathering and
that's right.
And design and feedback from the client.
That's right. But
how the hell do you shrink that in the long term?
So what? It's
just
that it's
doing two builds in the same price. An initial build that's
somewhat there. Problem. It's a time frame.
In a very tight time frame. Doing a first edition and an impression that will be formed that is a problem.
What he doesn't have to have get together, I know this slide deck intimately, is you do a great brainstorming phase with the client. You all their wish lists, and you prioritize, just like he said, just the high impact stuff. You launch bad stuff, it's just the high impact item.
Yeah, I know, but the problem is you're still thinking in the traditional sense of web design. You need to shift your thinking. And this is what happens as well. When we go to a client, we need to explain to the client how this now works. So it's not a case of winning a work 1 week and no starting it till 3 weeks later. It's about getting in and telling them, this is our process. If you're not happy with working with our process, then it may be better going and working with another agency, because this is how we work. And you need to be really strong with clients. And I know sometimes that might be hard when you need money through the door. But if you've got a process, you need to stick to the process. It does work.
That's great to hear, so I can test
it. It does work.
More confidence.
Yep. Okay, so we've moved on to the third phase, which is a continuous improvement. And this is really a roadmap for building a peak performance website. It provides focus, clear expectations for the client, and we need to measure the progress to the goals right through the entire process so that we're staying on track. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we're going to go through some of the metrics which we want to improve, some of the things that we want to improve on the website. These are the things that, in general terms, would be looked at via Google Analytics and how things are actually performance. The first one is your audience. Again, we've spoken about this. This is your buyer persona. These are the people, the users that are actually going to use the site. Value is related to the value that you're actually providing on the website itself. So that could be a services page, it could be a ROI calculator, it could be anything really, just any sort of marketing asset which brings people and provides value to their to the user. Usability, how usable is the website? The conversion rate optimization, very important, but you need to make sure you get the previous parts done first, because if your website's shit, it's still going to be shit, even though you've optimized it, it's just going to be unoptimized shit. So, yeah. Stickiness is about how many does the customer return, does the user return back to the site? If they did return back, then you can safely say that you're providing value. And personalization. So again, we've spoken about the different types of buyer personas. If you were working with HubSpot, for instance, they've got what's called a content optimization system. And what they do is they allow you to change the content based on the buyer persona. So if someone comes to your website and signs up on a landing page for to download a gated bit of content, you would then have their details. And what would happen is they would slip into a buyer persona, which you've already created in the back end, and a wee cookie gets added to their computer. So when they visit the next time, if they know that they are the director, they need to show that content. If they know that they are the sales director, they need to show that content, etc., etc. Similar to the way GF Lang, I suppose, works with different languages. Okay, assets. This is the tools I was talking about. Which provide value and assets for your website. So that would be like your ROI calculator, for instance, and anything else. I'm trying to think. Well, I mean, Joomla.org, for instance, have an extensions directory which provides value. That's an asset to Joomla.org. And promoters. So what we want to do is we want to get the users that visit the site to understand that we are providing a shared load of value to them, so we want them to become promoters of the website. So we want them to go out and tell people, you need to go and visit that site because it's not a Christmas tree and it's absolutely fantastic. Okay, so what we do is we select an initial metric, we set a goal for that metric. The goal needs to solve a user's point of pain. That's the whole point of providing value. So when somebody's searching for something in Google, they've got a pain, a bit of pain they're trying to solve. So they come across your site, and the hope is that it solves their point of pain. The focus metric for this, for instance, would be on a scale of 1 to 10, how useful was that particular point of value. So if someone's trying to work out the return on investment for inbound marketing, they could go to HubSpot.com, use their return, their ROI calculator, and it would give you the details that you need. So on a scale of 1 to 10, how useful was that for you? So the leading indicators would be things like bounce rate, and you know things like, which again we spoke about, how long the video has been played for, etc., etc. It just depends on what you're actually measuring. Okay. So what happens is we then start to take each metric through a four-point process, which is plan, build or develop, learn, and then transfer. The first one's plan. So what you need to do here is you need to obviously determine which step you're on. We've at this point chosen usability. Seems to not be loading. Okay, so what we've done is we're now at the plan stage. We've taken a metric which is usability at this point. What the task completion is to get to the product page from the home page. At this point, you need to start asking questions such as, is it obvious that there's a call to action there which takes you to the product page? Is it obvious that that buyer persona understands that's what their action is? And a whole array of other different assumptions that you need that you make at this point. You would do your user research through the data that you've gathered through analytics and other means, which would maybe even guide how you're going to start thinking about how to change things on that particular page. And at this point, what you want to do is you want to start brainstorming to come up with action items, which we spoke about earlier. And what the action items are things which we can add to the website, which improves the user on a kind of business level, how they are interacting with the site, where they are going, and also the website itself. So there'll be multiple action items, they're no kind of limited. Generally, during the strategies phase, we come up with 75 to 200 plus, but it's just as many things that you can think of, for instance, based on user research and the brainstorming and the questions you've asked to look at improving things. Okay, so what happens is we then start to filter the action items into high impact, medium impact, and low impact. What we're trying to do here is we want to get all the high impact items and filter them further so that we take 20% of the high impact items, which will provide 80% of the value to the users. And once we do that, we then create what's called a hypothesis statement on each individual high impact item. So for instance, for Market Mary visiting the home page, we believe changing the funnel tool graphic into an interactive and linked graphic will increase the home to product page conversion by 5%. Yep. Does anybody actually do this? Apart from us? Nah. Okay. So what you then do is you then put in your reasoning, which is we believe the first to be true because of whatever that research is. Yep. So you've already done experiments, and you're now going to apply that impact item. And what we're trying to do here is we're trying to look at the expected impact of the item versus the effort required. So if the impact item only provides maybe 10% of the value, but it's got to take 6 months to actually implement, then that's probably something you didn't want to do at that particular time. Now you need to include the experiment, you need to actually write out the entire experiment design as well, which means that whatever the experiment is, you need to actually write out and detail it so that everything is written down. Okay, so we'll now move on to the build phase. Okay, so at this point, this is where the entire team gets involved. So everybody in the team gets involved at this point. This is why we can reduce the time taken for a normal traditional launch of a website. So it's essentially the get shit done type of
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay. Type area. Okay, so I'm going to even speed it up even further, so I do apologise. So at this point, we're trying to implement the high impact items, yeah? And we'll set up the experiments to test them as well. So if you were changing like a button colour, for instance, you would set up a spot test. Okay, well, we're now moving on to the learning stage. So, I mean, it kind of speaks for itself, to be brutally honest. At this point, what we're trying to do is we're trying to review the results. Did the tests yield what we expected it to yield? What were the results? What did we learn about the users? Because this will obviously help us continually develop the website going forward. And then we need to publish the findings. So it's not just about keeping it to yourself. This is my baby, I've done this. You need to actually publish it, and you need to get out to not only your team, but also the client and whoever else is involved in the website itself. Okay, so we're now moving on to the transfer. And what the transfer is essentially is just a collaboration between different business functions. So you can share user learnings. So this would be like the sales and marketing, for instance. And you would ask questions as well. I mean, if you've got the user data, you can then start to go through that iterative process again and say, well, why is that like that? And why is this like this? And essentially what you do is you just repeat the cycle, just continually. It's a never-ending process, which is why it needs to be a month-on-month thing. And I'm pretty sure if your client was had 20 grand to spend, and you know, for that 20 grand, you couldn't tell him how many leads he's going to get, how many sales he's going to receive. You know, he's probably going, well, that's fine, because I didn't really know anyway. Whereas if on the other hand, if you can say, well, you know, the return on investment, is this based on what you're actually investing, this is what we expect to get out. But again, every business is different, so.
Yeah, it's not the fee-based.
Yeah.
It is the first
part. Yeah. But that's one of the core things about growth-driven design. It's about to get the user data, and we can't get the user data unless they're actually using it.
After the decision, maybe.
Yep.
Can't come
use the But the thing is, the client himself is likely will only care. What they care about is their website. They're not interested in how you're going to do it, how you're going to deliver it. In most cases, it's about the money. But I mean, the whole thing about growth-driven design is it's all user data. And the thing is, it's about continually growing and improving. So, that's right, yeah. So that's essentially what you would do, yeah. And that's what this whole continuous improvement is about. It's about, you know, approaching them saying, we believe that this will change, improve conversions because of that, so let's do that. And that's what happens next month for sprint. And again, it's just a repeat of the process. So just quickly to summarise, we've got a strategy, we've got a launchpad website, it's all about continuous improvement. We've got different metrics which we can build upon, and it's just a continual improvement. And when we look at the traditional web design process versus the growth-driven design process, you can see that it's clearly different. I mean, we didn't wait for a year and a half to 2 years before we make improvements, because we're continually making improvements. And if we don't make improvements, then there's that space of lost opportunity from the traditional web design process. And there's another layer onto this, which is the sales and marketing. And again, the sales and marketing will help improve GDD, and GDD helps improve sales and marketing. Okay, so going back to the differences of the traditional web design versus GDD in terms of the risks and results, growth-driven design solves pretty much all of these problems related to the traditional web design, which is we can spread the cost over time, we can launch quickly and improve as we go. It's much more agile, on time, and always on budget. The results are always data-based decisions. Yep. So if you're making data-based decisions, they're more informed decisions rather than just pulling something out there. And it's about continuous improvement as well. Okay, so Gabe again from Square to Market says growth-driven design is the new gold standard for delivering successful website redesigns that bring measurable business value. As a smarter, agile and data-guided approach that minimises the pitfalls of traditional web design and produces high-performing websites. So back to the story of Edmund. So Edmund was with his team climbing up the side of the hill, and he's at the brink of death with his team, and he's thinking to himself, shit, what am I going to do? So he started to say to himself, you know, we didn't need to stay on this path that we spent a long, long time devising. What we can do is we can change as we go, and I can see the visibility in front of me, I can see the obstacles. And lo and behold, on the 28th of May at 11:30 in 1953, his team made it to the summit of Mount Everest. Now I'm going to leave you with this one last thing. This is a quote from Sir Edmund Hillary, and he says, I will come again and conquer you, because as a mountain you cannot grow, but as a human I can. So what I ask you today as business people, marketers, developers, designers, is start thinking differently about your next web design, redesign process. Think about growth-driven design. It's a much better way for you to work. It's a much better way for your client to work. You just need to educate them. Now, just as you were saying, if you want to visit growthdrivendesign.com, this is the main website which, if you're a marketer, you can go on the deep dive training course on the left hand side, or if you're an agency, you can go on get the agency blueprint, it says there, but that's actually been taken over by Luke to HubSpot, and you can now be certified as a growth driven design agency. Thank you.